One of the best things about summer is that you get to start seeing your neighbors again, right? All winter long, you're there, maybe you pull your car right into your garage, you go in, unload your groceries, and you're looking out the window, and you're like, oh, the neighbors, they got a new snowblower. You're like, oh, what's going on over there? And you don't get to see your neighbors all that often because we don't like to spend time outside. But summer comes, and here we are. Now we get to see each other outside, mowing the lawn and catching up. And that's something I love to do, talk to my neighbors, see how they're doing, wave at them, you know. Good to see you guys. Now, but I have to make a confession, though, because a couple weeks back, I had to ask one of my neighbors a very embarrassing question. I went up to him, and this is my neighbor of probably 6 or 7 years, something like that. And I went up to him. He lives 2 houses down. And I said, hey, good to see you guys. And I got to ask you a question, though. Could you remind me of your first name? Oh, man, I felt bad. I had forgotten his name, and I tried to figure out what's a way I can get around this, try to figure out his first name. I couldn't. So I'm like, oh, all right, Jerome, good to meet you again, brother. Good to see you. And so as I've been getting to know some of my different neighbors and trying to not only hear their names but remember their names and start to hear about, hey, what do you do for a living? What do you do at your job? Hey, what are you in school for? And what are some of the things that are important? As I'm starting to get to know and foster some of these relationships, a question has come up for me. And that question is, what is God's ultimate intention for this relationship? The relationships that God has entrusted to me with my neighbors, where is the place that God is trying to take? Is it just knowing them, kind of, and waving at them when they're mowing the lawn? What is the thing that God is trying to do through this relationship? Yes, we're to love our neighbors, right? That's the second greatest commandment, to love your neighbor as yourself, second only to loving the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Have you ever thought about that? With some of your neighbors, maybe you live in an apartment complex, maybe you come out your door and you see your neighbors in the hallways or the stairs or the elevator, getting into the car, and you see how they're doing, and you wonder, what should be next in this relationship? Maybe you live on a street that you've lived for years, a long time. And you know all your neighbors, you've seen their kids be born and grow up and go off to college, and you wonder, hey, what is the relationship here supposed to be working towards? Maybe you've moved into a new neighborhood, and maybe you're trying to get to know some of the people that are around you, and you're wondering, all right, what does this look like for me to be the light of Christ to these people that I am meeting? Today, we're going to take a look at God's Word, and we're going to see what it looked like for Jesus to meet someone new. Jesus met someone new, and we could call her a neighbor of sorts. She was from a neighboring region. And as he came and started to talk with this woman who was rejected by many, we're going to see what are the things that Jesus brought up. What are some of the things Jesus focused on? What are some of the things Jesus asked her? As we do that, we're going to see 3 different reasons that we should love our neighbors. Today we're going to see those 3 different reasons that we should love our neighbor from the example of Christ. So let's go ahead and pray and ask God to work in our hearts today. Lord, we thank you so much for your work in our lives. Lord, I thank you for redeeming us, those of us who are your sons and daughters, for drawing us to you and transforming us. God, I pray that you would continue to be at work within us today to recognize what it is that you have done for us, the transformation story that you have given to us. And Lord, as we have these relationships, whether with people who live right next to us or who work right near us in our cubicle or wherever it is, God, I pray that you would give us wisdom about using these relationships, showing love the way that your son Jesus did. We love you, Lord. We pray all these things in the name of your son Jesus. And all God's people said, amen. Well, today we are going to see 3 different reasons to love your neighbors. And the first one is this. The first reason to love your neighbor is that Jesus himself is passionately pursuing the world. Jesus passionately pursues the world. You know, just yesterday we had kind of that big finale of our church garage sale. Anybody get a chance to go over to the church garage sale, either make some donations or make some purchases? I did. I was able to find some good things. So if you see me in an orange North Face sweatshirt, you can know that I got that for 50 cents at the garage sale. So when it starts getting cold and you see that, you could say, you got that at the garage sale, didn't you? And the answer is yes. But not only did I find found some clothes, that's a good thing to find, but this year I ended up searching for something I wasn't expecting to be searching for at the garage sale. And that is my almost 3-year-old son, Calvin, because he's a really fast little guy, and so I would turn around and all of a sudden, he was right there, and now I don't see him anywhere. So I find myself looking under tables and looking behind clothes racks, and even at one point, Pastor Keith said, "Hey, I'll watch Calvin for just a couple minutes while you take care of something." So I said, "Oh, great." I came back over, and Keith said, He was just right here. He was just here. And I said, "Oh, that's all right. We'll start looking for him." But here's the good news. Obviously, it's a safe environment. But Calvin was always going to the same place, the toy table. Because there's all these toys. It's like toy heaven. Every time he'd walk away, he's like, "All right, I just need one more thing. I just need to go get one more thing." He's got fire trucks, and he's got, you know, Duke Kaboom from Toy Story. And he was having a great time there. But I searched for Calvin passionately because I wanted to be with him. I wanted him to be with me and to be safe. And Jesus passionately pursues the world, those lost, those of us who he pursues. He pursues passionately. You know, we're going to take a look. You know, anyone here ever heard of, there's a TV series called The Chosen. The Chosen. And that's something that I've been able to watch with Emily. We love it. And so... By the way, not everything. I'm going to show us a little clip of what it may have looked like for Jesus to initiate this conversation with the Samaritan woman. Now, everything that they say in here is not quite taken exactly from Scripture, so it's not Scripture quotations, but it's what these conversations may have looked like. So let's go ahead and take a look at what it may have looked like for Jesus to be beginning this relationship with the Samaritan woman.
Give me a drink. Did you hear me?
That bad, huh?
What?
You, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a Samaritan, and a woman.
So Jesus set out and he began this relationship. He started to talk, and the thing is that Jesus was on a mission. Jesus was on a mission here. This wasn't just an accidental conversation. You see, Jesus, we could see there in verse 1 that Chad read for us so kindly, the Pharisees had heard that Jesus was making and baptizing more disciples than John. John the Baptist, in this series, they call him Crazy John. This guy, he's out there, he's in the wilderness, he's eating locusts, all right? Crazy John. I don't know if we're allowed to call him that or not, but... So the Pharisees had heard, all right, this other guy that had people following him, they were baptizing people over there. Well, Jesus has more people following him. Jesus was bringing these disciples, welcoming them to himself, and Jesus was taking them somewhere. Jesus was showing them what the kingdom of God was like and what it was all about and who he himself was. Jesus was passionately pursuing the world in that way. And Jesus went out of his way to pursue the lost. Jesus went out of his way. You know, the lost are the reason that Jesus left heaven. The reason that he came to earth. The reason that he endured the cross. He paid the ultimate price. What does it say in verse 4? Jesus had to pass through Samaria. Some Jews would go around so they didn't have to go through that. They would go the long way or a different way. And Jesus went through Samaria intentionally. And here's the thing about Samaritans. They were a racially mixed group of people that were partially Jewish and partially Gentile. And as a result of that, they had been rejected in large part by both groups. Jesus went to a woman who faced some real societal and spiritual challenges because he passionately pursues the world. Now here's the interesting thing. This conversation shows us that nobody is outside the reach of his love and grace. No one is outside the reach of the love and grace of Jesus Christ. The Samaritan woman came to the well at a time of day when it was really hot. When it gets really hot in the summertime, most of us go inside where it's air conditioned. A lot of the other ladies were getting water earlier in the day, but she came out because she had been socially outcast because of what sounds like a number of immoral relationships. Verse 16 says this, Jesus said to her, "Go, call your husband and come here." The woman answered him, "I have no husband." But Jesus knew the full story and he asked her a little bit more. Jesus said to her, "You are right in saying, 'I have no husband,' for you have had five husbands and the one you have now is not your husband. What you have said is true." But none of this is too much for the love of Jesus. Not the social rejection, that's not too much for him. The repeated moral failure, that's not too much for the love of Jesus. The cultural customs of that day are not too much for Jesus to overcome because Jesus passionately pursues the world. You know, maybe you're here today and you feel like an outcast. Maybe you're in elementary school, maybe you're in middle school or high school or college, and maybe the people that you spend time with have in some ways rejected you, have turned away from you and said, you know what, we don't really want to be by you. And maybe it's for a silly reason, or maybe it's even for a legitimate reason that they have decided to do that. But no matter what the reason is that any of us would feel outcast, I want you to know that Jesus passionately pursues people like you. Jesus passionately pursues people like me. So we see that Jesus pursues the world. He pursues people like us. That's a great reason to pursue our neighbors, right? To be looking for some of those relationships just as Jesus did. We get to know our neighbors. We show love to them. We look for ways to bless them. But is that all? Is that the end of the story? That's kind of my question I posed at the very beginning, and I believe the answer is no. That's not all that it means to be a Christ-like neighbor. Because there's a second reason for us to love our neighbors. And that second reason is that Jesus offers new life to all who will simply ask. Jesus offers new life to all who will ask for that. You know, Emily and I have a little bit of a different approach to asking for help. Emily has no problem asking for help, so it's very common to hear, "Hey, Dave," and yeah, she's one of the few people that call me Dave. "Hey, Dave, could you bring down the hairbrush from upstairs? Got to brush the kids' hair." Great. "Hey, Dave, could you put the kids to bed? That would be great." All right, very nice. And this is one I was not expecting when we got married. She would say, "Hey, Dave, can you get my toothbrush ready?" And I'm like, what does that mean? She's like, you know, put toothpaste on the toothbrush and then you set it on the counter. I'm like, I don't know. So apparently she grew up and in her house, that was a way that they showed love to each other. "I will get your toothbrush ready." I'm like, all right. So sometimes I do that. I did that last night. And in my house, however, growing up, we had 9 people. So nobody was lining up 9 toothbrushes and putting toothpaste on all those. You know, in a house of 9 people, sometimes you say, you know what? I've got to take care of something myself. That is just fine. So that's something that I've grown accustomed to, is rather than asking, I will try to do it on my own. So if I've got a project in my house or out in my yard, I'll try to do that on my own if I can. With varying results, all right? Sometimes it turns out well, sometimes not so well. But there's other areas of life, right? When you're stressed out, when you're going through something, sometimes you say, you know what, I'm just going to leave this on my own shoulders. But that's not what God wants us to do. He knows that we cannot handle some of the things that come at us. And so God wants you and I to ask him for help. What does it say here in our passage? We're going to take a minute just to take a look at our second clip here of what it might have looked like for Jesus to encourage the Samaritan woman to ask for help. Let's take a look at that clip together.
Amazing what a parched throat will do. Aren't I unclean to you? Won't you be defiled by this vessel?
Maybe some of my people say that about your women, but I don't.
Yeah? And what do you say?
I say if you knew who I am, you'd be asking me for a drink.
Really?
And I would give you living water.
Would? Except that you have nothing to draw water with, and this is a deep well. Besides, what do you need from me if you have your own supply of living water?
Long story.
But Jewish water is better than Samaritan water, hmm?
That's not what I said.
Are you a better man than our ancestor Jacob, who dug this well? Your water is better than his?
I know Jacob. And everyone who drinks this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks the water that I give him will never be thirsty again.
Wouldn't that be nice?
The water I give will become in a person a spring of water welling up to eternal life.
Really?
Yes, really.
Prove it.
First, go and call your husband and come back. I will show you both.
I don't have a husband.
You are right. You've had 5 husbands. And the man you're living with now is not your husband.
Jesus offers to the Samaritan woman living water if she will only ask. You know, living water here is kind of a visual description of a spiritual reality that would be going on, overflowing this living water that can take care of your thirst, that can fill you up and bring energy to you. And as I studied this, I thought to myself, what is living water? What is living water? You ever ask that question? I thought to myself, is it God's grace? Is it salvation? Is living water Jesus himself? Is it eternal life when we'll go to be with God in heaven? What is eternal life? And thankfully, as I studied it, I found the answer a few chapters later in John chapter 7. And Jesus tells us that living water is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit that is sent, that third person of the Trinity who comes to dwell within us at the moment of salvation. And when we receive that living water, here's what it says in verse 38. Jesus said, "Whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water." Now he said this about the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, whom those who believed in were to receive. How do we get the living water? How do we get the Holy Spirit? By believing in Jesus Christ. And the Holy Spirit is given to us. And that life flows within us. That life is found only in Jesus, but he gives generously to all who ask without finding fault. What does it say in verse 10? Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." So have you asked? Have you asked for that living water? Do you have the living water that Jesus is talking about? Is that part of your experience? Is that part of what God is doing in your life? I hope that you have believed. I hope that you have trusted and that God has sent his Holy Spirit to empower you, to dwell in you, to bear fruit within you. You know, maybe you're here today, maybe you're a mom. Maybe this last year has been more challenging for you than you ever could have dreamed. Maybe you've got young kids and school was a big challenge for you this year. Lots of twists and turns and unexpected things. Schedules are different for many of us. We wonder, okay, this is crazy. I'm getting so tired. Maybe you've had very little time to yourself. Maybe, ladies, you had your husband there working at home with you, working remotely, and maybe that was great, and maybe it wasn't so great at times. With all that's been drained out of us, with all that has been a challenge, sometimes we look around and we think, there is no living water anywhere in sight. But I want you to know this. With all that's been drained out of us, Jesus has sent the Spirit of God, the third person of the Trinity, to be within us the power that we need, to give us the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, to grow within us patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And while life is a challenge, and certainly there are twists and turns ahead yet this year, we know that God has not left us alone. He is here with us, dwelling within us, giving us that spring of living water. So we can ask Him to empower us, to change us, to give us the things that we need, to allow us to focus on the things that are His priorities for us. And He's given us the body as well. So He's given us the Holy Spirit, the end, right? Wait, no, that's not it. All right. You were once rejected, and now you are accepted. The end. Yes. No, that's not the end. Sorry. One more. You now experience eternal life that can never be taken away. The end of the story, right? No, that's not the end of the story. The woman here has one more scene unfolding within this drama, and that is that she cannot keep this good news to herself. That's the third reason that you should love your neighbors, is because living water that Jesus gives to us will remove our shame and overflow to others. That living water, the Holy Spirit's work in our lives, the fact that we are saved because of the blood and the power of Jesus Christ, that living water that Jesus gives will remove our shame. This woman experienced shame. Some of us here have experienced shame. But the love of Jesus Christ removes that shame from us and overflows to others. You know, I love the blooming trees, all the flowers, everything's incredible. And with this incredible summer air comes seasonal allergies. Anybody else here struggling with seasonal allergies? Your nose is running. Some of us have it down to the week. We know what week of the year that our seasonal allergies are going to show up, and our nose is running, and we can't stop sneezing, and we're drained, and our eyes are, you know, all itchy, and it's miserable, right? I can relate with that because that's actually one of the first things that Emily, my wife, ever knew about me. So one of her friends there in middle school, Lauren, was introducing her. She said, "Emily, and that's David, and his nose runs like a faucet." That was the first introduction that Emily had to me. His nose runs like a faucet, and it was true because my nose would run all the time. I had tissues in my back pocket. I had a red nose all the time, and I couldn't get it under control, trying all sorts of different stuff until finally, nasal spray. A godsend, right? And so I started this nasal spray and my nose stopped running. Wow, this is incredible. This is great. I can live life like a normal person. This is wonderful. And so when 2 weeks ago, somebody in my small group said, "Oh man, my allergies are killing me. I'm miserable." I said, "Hey, have you tried nasal sprays? It changed my life. I got to let you know about it." And so last week I was talking with that brother and he said, "You know what? I tried that nasal spray. And yeah, I'm feeling great. Everything has changed." I said, "Oh, that's incredible. That is wonderful, because when something changed my life, I wanted to share it with others." And when Jesus changes our lives, we have got to share that with others. We've got to share that with others. It should be overflowing, this overflowing living water. I want to take a look at our final clip of what it may have looked like for the Samaritan woman to be telling others.
"I have not revealed myself to the public as the Messiah. You are the first. It would be good if you believed me."
"You picked the wrong person."
"I came to Samaria just to meet you. Do you think it's an accident that I'm here in the middle of the day?"
"I am rejected by others."
"I know, but not by the Messiah."
"And you know these things because you are the Christ." "I'm going to tell everyone."
"I was counting on it."
"Spirit and truth."
"Spirit and truth."
"It won't be all about mountains or temples."
"Soon, just the heart.
You promise?
I promise.
This man told me everything I've done. Oh, he must be the Christ!
Hey, wait!
Your water!
You forgot your
Patsy, a man who told me everything I ever did!
Rabbi, we got food. What would you like?
I have food to eat that you do not know about.
Who got you food?
Wait a minute. You told her? Mm-hmm. And she can tell others?
What food?
My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish his work.
You told her where you are? Mm-hmm. So does that mean?
It means we're going to stay here a couple of days. It's been a long time of sowing, but the fields are ripe for harvest.
And so it's time.
Let's go.
Yes!
It's pretty cool, right? The living water that Jesus gives not only removes our shame, but it overflows to others. Should overflow to others. What does it say in verse 28? I'll give it to you straight from Scripture. So the woman left her water jar and went away into town and said to the people, "Come, see a man who told me all that I ever did. Can this be the Christ?" They went out of the town and were coming to him. And in verse 39, many Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. "He told me all that I ever did." If Jesus saved you, he has removed your shame. If Jesus saved you, you have a transformation story to share with others. If Jesus saved you, it has got to overflow to others. You know, you might not know all the theological terms, but you can share what God has done in your life. I'm going to be honest with you. I don't know the molecular structure of the nasal spray, but that doesn't mean I can't share the good news with someone else and have it spread to them. You can share your story if you used to rage in anger and hatred within your heart, but now God has given you peace. You can share that with others. If you used to despair and anxiety, feeling like everything was out of control and everything was falling apart, but now you recognize that God is in control and he gives you hope because of that, you can share that with others. If you used to struggle with sin, patterns of sin, sexual addiction or addiction to alcohol or drugs, but now you have been set free from that and given victory by the power of God, share that with others. If you used to despair that the universe was meaningless and your life didn't matter for anything, but now you know that God has created you for a purpose and has called you to be his child, share that with someone. These stories, these transformation stories, are things that we can share with those around us. As God gives us opportunities with some of those relationships that have been entrusted to us, whether it's our neighbors, whether it's the person in, across the hall at work, the person that you work right next to, whoever it is that God has put into your life, I encourage you to start showing love in those relationships. And when God gives you a chance to share your story, to share it with boldness. On the back of your sermon outline, there's a little box here for you to imagine your neighborhood. And I want to encourage you, draw a line. That's going to be your street. Draw that line, and right there you put your home. You can put your number, your house number. Put that on there, and then the people that are across the street from you, the people that are next door to you, write down their names. And if you don't know their names, you need to go ask again, then do that. In the meantime, you can put a question mark. And as God gives you opportunities to show love to our neighbors, take those opportunities. Take those opportunities to spread the love of Christ and allow the living water of Jesus to overflow. Take that paper, stick it on your fridge, stick it on your bathroom mirror, maybe stick it right underneath your TV and be reminded of the mission that you have been called to. We get to join in with the mission of Christ that we were able to love the people of the world. You know, every once in a while, I pull out my phone and I ask Google to help me navigate to the nearest Walgreens. And then there it is and I find it. But here's the thing. Jesus has placed you, of the billions of people on earth, Jesus has placed you as the closest Christian to your neighbor. Jesus has called you uniquely to that relationship. And my encouragement to us as a church is that we would be a group of people, not only who have been transformed by God, but who turn to others and share the hope so that they can experience that as well. I'm going to ask you to stand up, and I'm going to send you off with the final verse from our passage today, John chapter 4, verse 42. And it says this: "They said to the woman, 'It is no longer because of what you said that we believe, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this indeed is the Savior of the world.'"